Okay, welcome to the Lobo Podcast. Today we have Chicago legend, comedian Marvin Phipps. We talk about the Kanye birthday party, the Yeezy boots, the jokes and notes dates, the sex mansion. It's 8 weeks he went to jokes and notes. We would get on stage, but listen to that story. The sex mansion, the hookers, opening for Tracey Morgan. Again, James Webb is my producer. If you want to record a podcast, do a special, other cool digital stuff, hit up James Webb. Support the podcast, Patreon. $3 a month. Free content. Give me $3 a month. Help support the podcast, the network, my baby, everything. YouTube, please subscribe, tell a friend. And we have a sponsor now, right? We have a sponsor. And who wants to get laid? You guys like pussy? I like pussy. I get pussy. Ask my girlfriend. I'd be getting pussy. So go to LordVegas.com. 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 Live on a t-shirts, hats, hoodies, jackets, wallets, and bags. Independent, uncompromised. Elevate your lifestyle and go get some pussy. Look good, feel good, and fuck. I mean, do you want to be an incel? Do you want to like lose it one day and go all Columbine, AR-15s? Or if you get a bump stock, you can get, are they still legal? Anyways, you get some more rounds out. But anyways, go to Lobo Den. Go to LordVegas.com. Use a promo code LoboDen, save 25% off. I get a kickback from that. So if you want to support the podcast, you want to look cool, you want to get some cool gear, some cool bags, check it out. There's custom stuff they could do too. Probably. Did I add that? I don't know. Figure it out. Email them. LordVegas.com, promo code LoboDen, save 25% on. Okay, LoboDen. Okay, welcome to Lobo Den Podcast. I'm your host, Javon Diaz. To the left is James Webb from the People of Comedy Sealer Pop Productions. What's up, James?
What up, man?
And across from me, Marvin Phipps. We're going with Marvin Phipps. Yeah. Dubs, Marvin Phipps. That's where we're going professionally. Marvin Phipps, Chicago comedian. What does McKeef mean on your chain you got there? What is that?
MCEAF.
What's MCEAF?
That's man, that's an affirmation. Money comes easy and frequently that I got from The Secret.
The Secret.
Yeah, and I just been running with it, man. I done branched the fucking clothing. Can I curse on this?
Yeah, show? Yeah.
clothing line.
Just don't say the F word.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I mean, you can say fuck. Just don't say faggot. They can't.
Come okay. on, dude.
This is a LGBT open fucking whatever. Now. I said don't use it.
But
this is,
you know what?
Community, dude. This is community.
That's crazy, because in Chicago, we talk with that word.
I grew up,
you know what I'm saying?
We all grew up saying that word, but it was never negative.
It's
never
been negative.
Now it's a cancel word.
You could call your boy, you know, what up? You
know what is that word?
And now it's like, we can't even say
that. What your F ass doing?
But we still can, you know what? Stripped out, we still can say, you know, the N word, but we can't say the F word. That's fucked up.
Well, you can.
Well, you can.
Well, I can't.
I'm not going to say that.
Because here's what's like, I don't know if James know this, but
James, give us an N-word, hard R.
No,
I'm kidding. I'm fucking kidding.
But I used to when I used to go on stage, I used to go up and be like, "What up, faggot ass nigga?" That's how I used to open up.
Oh my God.
But I was at the Laugh Factory and my yeah, I used to say that every time.
Oh my God.
And my man Curtis hit me like, "Hey, bro."
He's mad you laugh at you, Curtis. Paul, yeah.
He said, "Hey, bro, I know you don't mean shit by it, but you can't say that." I said, "I can't say what?" He said, "You know." I said, "What, nigga?" He's like, "No, you can say." I said, "Why can I say nigga, but I can't say faggot?" He said, "Cause you black." I said, "Well, I guess I'm a faggot too. I'm gay. Fuck it."
You identify as a
but but I just stopped doing it, man. I ain't trying to offend nobody, but that's crazy. But in Chicago, we talk.
Well, you grew up in the South Side, right?
South Side.
You still living in the South Side?
No. I'm in the burbs now, man. I sold out. I got as far away.
You got it too.
I got a family.
You
I got
kids, right? Yeah. You know what I mean?
I got the fuck out the hood, bro. Yeah.
Where in the South Side you grew up?
Inglewood, bro. 63rd. Shit. Yeah, man. Ashland, 79th, 63rd Street. I went to Curie High School.
There was 9 of you, right?
9 of
you. You're the youngest of 9?
Yo, you did your homework, bro.
Dude, just wait.
Damn.
Just wait.
Don't bring a... Oh, you peed in the bed, right? Till you was 17? Like, who the hell you was talking to? Yeah. It was 9 of us, bro. One of my sisters passed in 2013, so it's 8 of us left. But, yeah, single mom. Raised 9 kids by herself, bro.
Jesus. That's a thug.
Yeah, she's a beast with it, you know? Yep, she'll be 70 this year, too.
Happy birthday. When's your birthday?
My birthday?
What's her birthday?
June 13th, my mom's birthday. We're going to try to put something together for something nice, you know. But this is like, when you got that many brothers and sisters, bro, you can't agree on shit, bro.
Are you guys competitive? My sister had like, not my sister, my baby mama, or my girlfriend has like, there's like nine of them or something like that, you know what I mean? So they were competitive, they were fun.
Always.
It's different, you know what I mean?
It's always, because you fighting for your space, bro, like. And my wife didn't understand this because she's the single, she's a single kid.
A single child?
When you grew up with such a large family, every day is a fight. You know what I'm saying? Because it's like, it's never enough food. It's never enough space. You know what I'm saying? You get out your seat, somebody got it when you get back. You know what I'm saying? You want that last piece of chicken, you go in the kitchen, it's gone. It's like, it's something. You know
what I'm saying? Survival, man. It's a different mentality. You know, you grew up differently.
Yep. Like, but it was fun though. That's why I became a comedian, because growing up in that situation, my mom didn't have a lot of money, so we had to play a lot of games and we had to do a lot of entertainment around the house. So we made
shit. You had to figure it out, you know what I mean?
Yep. Yep.
What kind of games did you guys play?
Like, we just did, like, it's crazy. Like, we just did shit in the house, like playing, like, we'd just make up stuff, man. We did like sketches or just did like comedy stuff, man, with the family. Just crazy shit.
You ever do, what's that game where you attack people and then that one kid gets that racquetball thrown against him? Is that wall ball, remember?
What?
You get a racquetball or a tennis ball, right? And you got to throw it at the wall and pick it up. And like, whoever drops it or whatever, if he doesn't pick it up and drops it, he has to go to the wall and everybody.
I ain't never heard of that.
Man, you know what I'm talking about, James?
No, what the fuck are you doing?
That's some shit.
So this is, I used to caddy. I was at a country club.
Yeah,
so
I'll look it up.
That's where I learned how to gamble. Okay. That's where I learned like a lot of things. I didn't lose my virginity.
Yeah, them rich people games, bro. We had rock, paper, scissors.
This is, you get a racquetball. This is what you do. You get a racquetball, the blue one, right? Because they get left over or something, or a tennis ball. So you throw it and you catch it, but if you throw out the wall, a brick wall, and you catch it, and if anybody misses it, that guy who misses it, he has to run to the wall before somebody else grabs and throws it. And if you miss, that dude has to stand at the wall by himself, and then everybody gets to throw a ball at him.
Suicide?
Wow. Is that what it's called? Suicide? It's
butts
like
up or suicide? Here, hold
on. Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
So I mean,
butts up.
Yeah, because that's where I learned how to gamble.
Wall ball.
Yeah, wall ball or something like that.
Ball. For sure.
Nah, we had beat your ass ball. Man, where I'm from.
Well, did you have a last straw when you, how long, when'd you leave? When'd you go to the suburbs? Because I grew up in the suburbs, kind of.
So 2015, I moved to Calumet City. And then just this November, I bought a house in South Holland.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Calumet City, is that the city that has those damn trains that run through it?
Yeah.
I did a show out somewhere around that area, and I remember I was at a light, and a train drove by for like 10 minutes, and then it stopped, and I was like, all right, here we go, I gotta get to the show. And I got there in plenty of time, and then two more trains came. It was like around Camelot City. It was with Vikram Pandey or something like that. He had some shit like that.
Calumet City is like east. It's like by Torrance, 147th, around in that area.
M. Brown, doesn't he live out there?
I don't know what.
He's south.
M move every fucking weekend. Shout out to M Brown. That's my guy.
How you started? You started comedy. What you saw some on MySpace, right? And you started going to Jokes and Notes for like a few weeks.
Holy shit.
8 weeks, right? 8 weeks before you got on stage.
Yep. I saw this guy, man, posting open mic on 47th and King Drive, and it was just like.
Which is Jokes and Notes, right?
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, it was Jokes and Notes. But for me, it was unbelievable that it was something like that going on so close to me, because I wasn't that far. I was staying on like 95th and Kersey at the time. And I called my brother, like, yo, they got an open mic spot on 47th and King Drive. I'm going to check it out. And I went, and it was Little Real hosting it. And I'm looking at this guy talking about the shit that I say all the time. I'm like, I think like that. So I went back like a week later with my cousin, and I said, I'm gonna try that. I'm gonna get on stage. And he's like, no, you're not. And so the process was, you sign a list, you come back. So I did that 8 weeks in a row. And every week, Real would be like, I'm gonna put you up. I'm gonna put you up. And it never happened. So the eighth week, I had my family, like everybody there. The owner, Mary Lindsay, was like, you gotta put this out. He's been coming. And he put me up that night, and I never looked back. That was November 23rd, 2007. I never forget the day. It was the day before Thanksgiving. It was a Wednesday night.
Black Wednesday.
Yep. And I went up, and at them times, I thought I did good. But if I go back and watch that stuff, I'd be like,
do you remember what you talked about?
Nope. But what's crazy is, and I tell a lot of new people, I was already funny because this is what we did in my family. So it was just me working on the other things like stage presence and holding a mic. But I know, I talked about my family, you know, how we grew up poor and things that I always wanted to say. And I talked about my family. And yeah, I got people to laugh, but it was no structure. It was no delivery. It was no, just raw.
Did anybody say anything after your set? What'd your cousin say, or Rel, or?
Yeah, everybody was like, you know, yeah, okay. Like, we see it, you know what I'm saying? You got to put the time and the work in, but you definitely got some, you know. And I became a local favorite, bro. Like, every week, people was requesting me to go up, put that guy up. And every week, I went from not going up to every week I was going up.
You remember your first show you did, like, after Mike?
Leon Rogers was the first person to put me on the show. And my goal was, when I started at Jokes and Notes, I never went up to anybody getting their phone numbers or anything, right? I felt like if I was doing something right, people would reach out to me. And that's what I did. And I was driving, and Leon Rogers called me. I never gave him my number. I didn't even know Leon. He said, hey, I heard you the new kid on the block. They saying you funny. I got a show for you. And he put me on this show, like a Christmas Eve show. That was the first show I did.
How'd you do?
I don't know. I probably, you know, at that time, like I said, I was getting laughs. I was making people laugh, you know. I was just, you know, just making people laugh. But if I say today, it probably was terrible.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But yeah, I mean, look, I remember my first set. I was, it was an open mic, and I was talking about, like, you talked about your family. I didn't talk about my family or my personal life for 2 to 3 years.
Wow.
After doing stand-up. You know what I mean? I just talked about nonsense.
Okay.
You know, it was bad. It was very vulgar, you know what I mean?
Oh, okay.
Sexual. Like, and it was anything, nothing about my, until I was in Milwaukee, I was at an open mic, and this dude, and I mentioned something about my dad, because my dad got deported, right?
Okay.
Like, maybe 10, 12 years ago, Obama deported him. Anyways, he got deported, and I mentioned, I had a joke about it. I threw something in there, and he was like, he pulls out me. He's like, your dad got deported? He's like, I had no idea. Like, oh, you're over here talking about jagging off for some nonsense. Right. And it's like, you've never, why don't you talk about it? And I was like, oh, yeah, I never thought about it. But like, for two, I was figuring my shit out. Like, yeah. I had no stage presence. It was real bad. And I was like, oh, yeah, I can talk about this stuff. Yeah.
I knew early on what separated me from a lot of people was going to be my family. You know, the dynamic. I got 6 sisters and 2 brothers.
Your brother's stand up, right?
He started after me, like 2-3 years after me.
Ronnie
George, yeah. And I knew if I talked about my family, that was going to separate me from a lot of people. Because quite naturally, growing up in Chicago public schools, we're going to say a lot of stuff, you know, similar. Even if I go to comedy shows now, everybody's touching on Corona or Lori Lightfoot or. So you had to learn how to be able to talk about those things, but differently. You know what I'm saying? And I knew if I talked about my family, you're not going to be able to touch on anything I talk about.
Yeah.
Because you don't got 8 brothers and sisters.
Yeah, because, well, you know when something happens and you go on your Facebook feed, everybody has the same joke about the same thing in the news. So whenever you talk about, like, everybody's talking about, I don't know. Has anything happened in the news lately? Kanye, you saw.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
What? Why are you laughing about? Look, Kanye,
you're
a father.
Dude.
How many kids do you have?
I got 4.
You have 4 kids right now.
Yeah.
Right now, are you married? Or
I'm married.
You're married, right? Yep. But all your first kids.
By a different woman.
By a different
two,
woman.
I got 2 by my first girlfriend. We was never married. And my wife, she has a son. And we have a child together, but they're both mine. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I got 4 boys, all boys.
4 boys. So, and right now you have a relationship. How's your relationship with your first?
We good. Yeah.
But were you always good?
No, bro. It take a while. You know what I'm saying? And it's a roller coaster. We was good, then you don't be good, then you be. You know what I'm saying? So, but now, we finally at the place. She's happy. She's in a relationship. You know what I'm saying? So, I be telling guys, like,
so it's easier for you now that she's happy, right?
When she's not happy, ain't nobody, and that's just true. Like, if you dealing with a one, if she ain't happy, she's gonna make your life hell, bro. You know what I'm saying? Just period. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, she's good. We good now.
Does Kanye have an Instagram?
Play the rant.
Yeah, go to the rant. Because you know what happened, right?
I'm just wishing my daughter a public happy birthday. I wasn't allowed to know where her party was. There's nothing legal. They're saying that these are the kind of games that's being played.
At the light,
it's the kind of thing that really has affected my health.
Yeah, fucking so stupid.
Is he driving or somebody driving?
Yeah, he's driving for sure.
I wonder what kind of car is that.
Probably a Maserati or some crazy shit. Toyota,
Corolla,
something. Prius.
I saw that.
And we're going to be in real time. Take a slight right turn.
Who's the voice on that GPS he has over there?
It's like George Bush or something.
So do you have the video afterwards? Because Travis Scott gave him the address. Oh, wait, what is this? Hold on, let me see this.
Wait, Travis Scott gave?
Travis Scott was like, man, I can't do this to you. Oh, he showed up to the, I think he crashed the party.
He did show up.
He showed up.
Yeah.
Yeah, he showed up. Wasn't he hitting the piñata or something like that?
Yeah.
But
yeah, Kim was trying to keep him away from his daughter.
Now you're dead. Like because my girlfriend has a 10-year-old son, and they have a co-parenting where they're 50-50, right? Which is rare.
Okay.
You know, usually it's like weekends, but they're 50-50.
Okay.
So like, there's this times like when you have your kid, you have him. When she has him, she has him, and it's almost like but legally on days they don't have him, you don't have to invite him. You know what I mean? So it's a weird thing where it's like, he's still the dad you wanted to be there. So I see where Kanye's coming from. Like, it's his daughter's birthday, and he wants to be there for his kid. But then, I don't know. What do you think?
I think Kim, she bogus. You know what I'm saying? Like, you use the power that women use when they don't want shit to, they don't want you to be involved. And that's a whack-ass card, bro. You know, that man just want to be there for his kid, bro. Like,
it's his birthday. It's her birthday.
It's her birthday. And like he said, Ye made a valid point. All that child is going to see is my dad's
not
here.
Dad wasn't there.
They don't care that we going through a divorce or some technical difficulties. They just like, my dad didn't come. And you wrong for taking that away from Ye. You wrong. He should have been there. Now, if you presented that and told him the address and this and that, and he like, yo, I can't make it. I got, to make my album, whatever. Now, he's bogus. You know what I'm saying? But if you didn't do any of that, Kim, you bogus.
Was Pete Davidson there? I don't know. How's it?
He probably was.
This is your new daddy, Pete. This is your new daddy, Pete, right here.
And it's just messed up, man. It's like... No matter how much money you got, bro, you still gonna go through this shit with your baby. That's crazy.
Kanye baby mama drummer
is a billionaire. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. He creates Yeezys. Like, this man can't get an invite to his kid.
He ran for president. He ran for president.
Ran for president. You know what I'm saying? It's like, that's crazy, bro. I felt bad for him, and I'm telling you, I know Kanye. Like, we call him crazy or bipolar or whatever, but I fuck with Ye. I love Kanye. Like, I always have. Even when he was rocking with Trump, whatever. You know what I'm saying? You gotta be crazy for your fucking sandals to be $380 fucking dollars. You know what I'm saying? Like, you couldn't do regular stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is what people don't understand. I get it. I understand, like, why he do the things he do, because when he drop his Yeezy slides, they're going to sell out. Yeah. Right? If he didn't do the crazy stuff he do, them bitches would sit on the shelf. Like, nobody would buy that shit. So you got to put on a mega hat. You got to say crazy shit. You got, like, this dude made boots, and they're $500, and they're sold out. Fucking moon boots. Like, you can be a regular guy and drop those boots and people rock them.
What was that? What album drop that he had? You went to his website. Remember? Doo-wop? Can you?
Oh, God.
Crazy. Yeah.
He had an album drop and everybody went. You went to the website.
Scoopity-poop or whatever.
Scoopity-poop. But this is what I'm saying. This dude had a listening party in an arena and didn't say a word.
And Curtis was there.
And
was
yeah, Curtis and, went. And people was lined up.
Yeah.
And so I was asking people, because some of my guys were, I said, so what did Ye, what did he, they say, bro, he didn't say a word. I said, he didn't speak. He didn't say, what's up? What's up, y'all?
Was that a Soldier Field? Where was that at?
Yeah, he did Soldier Field. Field.
I said, he, bro, look at them boots, bro. He got grown ass rappers. Like the game. Like, and I want a pair. And them bitches like.
Oh, me too. Dude, look at them.
Oh my God. I never seen them.
You never seen them boots?
Oh, no.
They was retail for like $500, but now, like, how much they going for now?
1,700
pounds.
Dude, that's like, that's euros. Like $2,300. No, that's pounds, dog.
Oh, that's pounds?
That's euro?
No, that's pounds. 14, okay, they're going down. But that's still so much fucking
Find
money.
My size in a 14. What's a 14 in UK?
God, fuck to find, though.
What site you on, bro?
13.5. We can go 13.5.
12.5.
We go to 13.5 is the
go
biggest.
Here, let's go to size guide. So, UK, US men, 14 is what? So it's the same.
So, much. 13.5. Go to 13.5.
Yeah.
Wait, do they got them?
I don't. You got fucking $1,200.
Yeah, I buy them bitches right here. Anybody bought a
13.5 is the last one.
Let's see if you can check out. If you can check out, I buy them bitches.
I've spent worse money. Like,
how did you even know to go to this fucking site, bro?
Don't worry about it.
Would they ship that shit to Chicago?
Yeah, they'll import it. Import duties included. So it's 3,145 pounds.
Okay, how much?
Which is roughly $4,000.
So how much is it in American money?
$4,000.
Are you fucking crazy?
You said doopity, you
wanted them. Scoopity.
I'll keep checking out if you want, dude.
Scoopity. Nah, bro. Okay. No, I'm thinking you finna say about 600-700.
No, dude.
$4,000.
$4,000. Something like that.
Plus import fees, yeah.
Oh, nah.
Duties and taxes.
But this is what I'm saying. But this is what I'm saying, though, bro. You cannot do regular shit and have $4,000 boots that's online.
Should I do crazy stuff too?
Hold yeah. You're going to have to, bro.
Yeah.
Because Kanye, man, you know. But he shouldn't be going through this, though, you know.
Yeah.
I think Kim.
I'm going to drink some vodka.
I think Kim. I'm like, you better be careful, Kim. Because when the first thing I saw was him making that video in his car. Then the next time I saw Kanye, he was at that fucking birthday party.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like. You can't play with Kanye. Like, you ain't gonna be able to pull that shit with Kanye, man.
It's like when somebody don't pay you and you call them out on Facebook. I mean, you're not gonna get your money. I've never seen people get their money. Oh, this is disgusting. I don't know if it's a vodka or just a flavor. So Armor Light Strawberry Lemonade is not a good flavor. Yeah. But like, should you do any crazy stuff to get attention? Have you done crazy stuff to get attention? Now
nah,
this is.
I mean, I just believe it's about the type of person you are and what you're willing to do. Like, that's just not me. You know what I'm saying? But I
you wear those jackets.
But I just really think I look good in them. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I'm not wearing them like, hey, this is going to star some shit. I just really like fucked up jackets.
You wear the who's Wolverine's enemy?
Sabretooth?
Sabretooth. You come to show looking like Sabretooth.
I just like fur, bro. Like, yeah. I just like fur. And a lot of the shit, it was like where I shop at.
Mm-hmm.
It's so cool.
Oh, that is beautiful, actually.
Well, yeah,
that's a sick coat, dude.
That's a Sherling. That's a Sherling coat. Yeah, I love that coat. That's a Jordan Craig. A lot of people think it's a Gucci.
You don't look good with that coat?
It's not a Gucci. It's a. It's
oh, all those boots. Oh, my,
bro.
They match, dude.
Bro, I'll pay about. I'll probably pay about.
2,000?
Nah, I won't pay that much. Probably 1,000.
I'll look at my other spots and see if I can find them.
A stack. I'll spend a stack.
What's the worst, not the, you feel like the stupidest thing you spent like a lot of money on before? I mean, I'll give you a second to think. I was watching videos on my car,
mm-hmm.
My piece of shit car. After my car, I'm going back to a Honda. I don't know. I don't like it. I have a electric car, right? And mm-hmm. They're kind of annoying. I got in a fight with Bobby Hill a little bit on Facebook before because I was like, hey, the mileage isn't, in my opinion, if you want to get an electric car, it needs to have at least a 500 mile to be worth it. Otherwise, get a gasoline car. Mm-hmm. And then I could pay for an upgrade on my car to go from 4.30 to 60 to 3.9.
Okay.
And just over your phone, over Wi-Fi in the morning. You know what I mean?
Really?
Uh-huh. And I was like, it's stupid. I was single at the time. Then, I have a kid on the way. in March 10th. I got to baby my first baby that I know of.
Congrats.
Thank you. And then, but at the time I was single, I had disposable income. I think I was just watching videos on my car. I was like, all right, if you get the upgrade, and I was like, watch videos for about an hour or two on YouTube, and I was like, fuck it. I charged my credit card $2,000
okay,
to go from 4.3 to 3.9. And I was, and like, now I wouldn't do it now, you know what I mean?
Was
like,
it worth it though? Do it, do it?
Yeah.
So you just got, you, bro, you're talking to a person that.
I think it was worth it.
I do stuff like that. I got cars, like, I got old schools. I got bad habits.
Oh, yeah. What is that? I saw your Instagram. What is that? Pimp. I was thinking about it. You can be like a pimp my ride. I saw all those old school cars. What are you doing? I got
cars.
Is that you?
Yeah. I got cars, bro. That's my Chevy Caprice. That's an 87. I just got that top and that roof put in. It's getting some more work.
Broham. I've heard that.
Yeah, it's a Broham. Broham just mean the top, the whole full top. You know what I'm saying? That's my Monte Carlo. I just got the interior done. A guy doing my.
You could do like a pimp my ride Chicago.
I do that. And believe
it or
not.
Do you film this?
It's a lot of comics that has like cars, like Carlos Miller out of Atlanta.
People love cars. You should do like a Pimp My Ride or a car. Like Leno has his car showing out.
Leno is crazy with his cars. Yeah. So I spend my
Oh, let's see that booty.
I spend.
Who's that? It's not your wife, right?
Just read the caption.
If you look very closely, you can tell whoever built the garage. Very skilled. I'm not sure what kind of brick.
This is funny.
I'd have to ask a good friend, Leon Rogers. Oh, nice man, work like this.
You should, if you go on Facebook and read the comments, because what I do is I post pictures like that, and we talk about everything.
That was a big ass for the audio people.
We talk about that, the everything except the picture, but explaining the picture. You know what I'm saying? So we won't get in trouble by our wives. So guys getting on there like, yo, that's a very nice garage.
That was a solid construction.
Yeah, that was a solid garage. I'd stick my car in it.
Like a brick house.
Yep. And then spill some white oil in it.
Yeah, we always do stuff like that. But yeah, so.
And then get it pregnant and freak out that I have to call my girlfriend and be like, look, man.
Yeah.
We're going to have to push this girl. No.
Bro, I got too many hobbies, bro. I buy cars. I buy guns.
I love guns.
I buy cigars. Shoes. My shoe collection is crazy. So you're talking to a guy like, it's no stupid purchases. If you want it, buy it.
I have friends that do this. And you think it's part of it is because when you're younger, there was none of you didn't have it. So now it's like, yep. Now.
And it just keep me busy too. And I tell my wife.
I don't hand.
Like my wife is always like, but she's cool. She's like, you know, I told her, I said, either I'm collecting shoes or I'm collecting women.
Exactly.
Like, you know, that really keeps me away. Like, I do what I do. I do my shoes. I do my cars. So now I can't even afford to have a side chick. It's like.
I used to, like, it's the kind of the same thing I had where I was like, I had to keep myself busy, right? Because I used to be, you know, I used to be drink. Kind of, I would consider myself an alcoholic.
Okay.
Drugs, allegedly. But
allegedly.
Man, jobs, allegedly. I throw it in there for whatever, day jobs, things like that, having a baby. But allegedly, which means, you know what it means. So then I would always keep myself busy, podcast, mic, whatever. Because then that I don't hand, especially when I would drink, that's when I would, like, my worst was drinking and a combination when I was drinking and trying to get pussy together. Like, I don't know where the fuck I would end up. You know what I mean? If I was just drinking, whatever. But if I was trying to do both, like, I did not give a fuck, dude.
I feel you.
So that's why, like, either I got to keep myself busy. You know what I mean? Now.
So what you do now? Are you still single?
No, I got my girl. We live together or whatever.
So that keeps me, like, doing comedy shows. Of course, you meet so many women. You're meeting people every day. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I got my wife. I do my shoes. I buy my guns. I buy my stuff. So with all that stuff, it keeps me busy, bro. It keeps me going. And I also drive trucks. I got a trucking company. So it's like, I don't got time for nothing.
Yeah,
else.
You keep yourself busy. Like, the idle hand is the devil's playground.
It is, bro. And I don't need to be doing nothing. Like, if I'm doing nothing, I'm usually end up on Craigslist. Buying bitches for 20 roses, like,
here, I found some
roses. I remember that. You know what I mean? It's kind of racist on there because a lot every third girl was no black guys, at least in the suburbs.
Really?
In the suburbs, it was like, and these are they'd be yeah. So I used to man back in the day out before Backpage. Mm-hmm. When Backpage shut down was one of the greatest days of my life.
Okay,
because if I was like, that's one less thing I had to worry about it. Because when I was sober, Jabani. Let me fuck hookers. drunk Giovanni, motherfucker. I was taking Ubers to the hotel by Steak and Shake and Gurney. Yeah. I had a chick. I had this hooker's number. I had like, man, catting. Remember catting?
What's that?
Carrying golf bag for rich. Okay. Well, okay. For my case, for rich Jews, but rich golfers. You know what I mean? It was a Jewish country club. Shout out to Northmore. But anyways, he's also a customer of mine, so I got to watch what I say because they just bought some stuff for me because my day job, I sell golf equipment. But anyways, caddying, like there's all these adult Mexican males, horny drunks, and then there's these kids who are caddy. We all have the same job because it pays well, and if you don't have papers, you get paid in cash. So you have older, this is how it works in caddying, the hierarchy. If you're an old white dude, you're an alcoholic. If you're an old Mexican dude, you don't got papers, so or you got a fake name, but it's really good money, you know what I mean? So it pays the money well. And you're a kid, they encourage kids to come and caddy because you can start at 13, you know what I mean? Really? So I was 16 years old, 13 is an exception. You can start working as a caddy at 13 years old.
They pay you cash.
Cash, you know what I mean? Like, I still caddy. I caddied the other day. I made like $800 in 2 days.
Why is
cash.
It, like, how is it that you're making so much money? Is it because these guys are so rich or what?
So you get your regular rate. Like, if I go and do a regular round for like four and a half hours, I think I make, the regular rate I make is $170 in cash and I can go home. But if there's tournaments, you know, I did this tournament, like you'll get tipped extra or like the tournaments, there's a lot of money. They'll tip you. Like I did 2 days with these old dudes at this place called Bobolink where it's an old school club. Actually, no women are allowed at Bobolink. Yeah. Like, I don't know. There's no member guest. One of the few clubs, them, Butler National, there's no women. Even Augusta, you can't. Like back in the day, the moms had to drop off the kids. They couldn't even get out in the parking lot. Wow. You know what I mean? Yeah. Right. Yeah, old school. And it's still like that. No women members allowed. It's a boy, it's all men. You know what I mean? I think Dicka's a member there, old Italian club. And then I went there, it was just 2 days, and the guy just signed me $800. So he just paid me $400 a day.
And you're just carrying around.
You don't carry. You just run around. They're on the carts, you run around, give them yardages and read their greens. So at Bobolink, nobody carries. At other clubs, you carry. There, you're just running around with them on the cart. You know what I mean?
That's crazy.
But yeah, so when I was there, I you know, that's where I learned gambling. That's where this Mexican dude told me about some whorehouse when I was 16 years fucking old. And I was like, really? You know, I'm a 16-year-old kid, or maybe hopefully I was 17 or 18.
Okay.
And then I went, and I was like, oh, shit. Then I went the whole summer after caddying, like, bah.
You go there.
And then I stopped for a few years. And I was like, you know what? This is out of control.
Where's this place located?
Oh, they shut it down. Oh, but then Backpage came on. It was in North Chicago, so it was kind of shady. Which is just north of Waukegan.
Okay.
So then I went to, and then I was done, and then Backpage. And then one time I was drunk, and I was like, really? I was watching Joe Rogan, and there was a chick on there talking about, like, you know, the dangers of something in Backpage. She's like, she was doing an expose on it, how bad it is. Okay. And I was just like, wait, Backpage. You know what I mean? And I'm in my early 20s. I was like, oh, let me check it out. I was drunk right now. I checked it out. And then you see, kind of opens your eye. Oh shit, there's hookers everywhere you go.
Everywhere.
And they're in every hotel that you go to, and like anywhere you go to a hotel, they're there. And I had no idea. And I was like,
they saying no black guys? What was
in the suburbs? It was, I don't know, but it was like UT ads. It was no black guys.
What was they, black guys coming fucking and not paying, or like what?
Oh, I don't know.
What the fuck?
Because I was thinking about it. I never asked. I'd like to get a hooker. I don't know if they're not paying or if people were getting set up. And I was like, is this dick too big? I couldn't figure it out. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't want to deal with it.
I seen a black chick said no black guys.
Yeah, I've seen that. Black chicks were saying no black guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's crazy.
Maybe they just want a fucking easy job. They don't want Asians only.
What I hated was like, when you order a chick and she showed up and she didn't look like the person in the picture, I'm like, I didn't order you. You are fucking, you're not the chick.
I want a discount.
Yeah, I want my money back.
It happened to my friend, and I won't say what state it was, but it was up north. And there's that picture he got there. It was this old woman. She was like, looked like she was 60 years old. But where they were working, there was a middle of nowhere, right? And there was nothing else.
So he had to do it.
So he was like, fuck, yeah. He fucked some old. You had to do it.
Bro,
what I mean?
You got to do it. You ordered her. She came. Fuck it.
And it was fucked because I would order them, and I didn't even live there. You know what I mean? I was staying at my buddy's house, at his mom's house, and there was this middle room. And then, like, to me, looking back, the audacity, I owed some hooker to come to my friend's house. And then.
Hey, these kids are never, no, bro, like. Those was wild times, bro. Like,
how'd you discover it? The Mexicans got me. I took a, allegedly took some kid to lose virginity at one of these houses who was younger.
Jokes and notes. It used to be these group of women that used to come to the shows, and every time they came, they was flashing.
Oh, really?
Like, during the whole show. So, one particular night, I think it was Lil Real. He said, "Where's you guys coming from, or what the hell you do?" It was always like 12 or 15 ladies. So they told him, they gave him this black card, and it was like black women, some discreet name with a location. So some guys was going, like they went that night. And so some guys called me and was like, "Bro, you should have came." And I'm like, whatever. So I go the next time. It was like every month on like a Wednesday. And when I went, bro, it was like, it was just naked people everywhere. Everybody was freaking naked. And they had this woman come to the door and show you around. So I'm in there like trying to talk to people like, "Hey, so you come here often?" They like, "Do you want some pussy or not? Like, we don't have to, you don't have to talk. You don't have to, nothing."
That happened with my friend, dude. I was out in Miami and he was doing that same shit. He was like hollering, and I was like, and I was already experiencing the hooker game. I was like, "Dude, what are you doing? Why are you hitting on him? Like, we're at the, like..."
You're at the whorehouse, and you, I'm talking about, you're not paying any money. There's no money, it's just, it's a big mansion. Mm-hmm. So what it was, it's like a swingers thing. Mm-hmm. So it was guys, you supposed to brought a woman, mm-hmm. but by us being comics, they let us in. So typical guys had to bring a female. And if you didn't have a female with you, it was costing $200 to get in the house. But if you brought a female with you, it was like $50. But they let the comics in free. So
that's a hell of a comp.
So when I went, it took me like 6 times for me to stop going. I was like, because every time I went, I was like, "You know what? I'm not fucking going back to this. It's like just the devil, bro." I'm like, it's too much. It's so many rooms. Then you start seeing people you know, like, no! you look like, "Is that my 6th grade teacher?" It's like, it's like everybody's in this spot. So, and then you're seeing comics naked. You're like,
"What the fuck, man? What you doing damn for?"
I don't want to see fucking Reggie Rich naked.
Bald head,
fucking naked. You know what I'm saying? But I'm the guy in there with his clothes on. Everybody else fucking naked.
You got your jacket.
I got my fur on. And they're like, "Hey, bro." It was crazy. Like I said, I told my brother, and I told Famo, comedian Famo, and my brother. So we go this night, right? So the guy knows me and my brother at this point. So he's telling us, he said, "You and your brother is good. I don't know this guy. He got to pay $200. So Famo is like, "I ain't paying no $200 getting this fuck. So he turns around. So as soon as he turns around, a woman opened a door, and she's naked. And he turns around and see her. He's like, "How much is it again?" And he paid the money and walked in. And he stayed all freaking night. All night. So comedy got me into like seeing that type of stuff. I never even knew stuff like that existed, bro. It was crazy.
No, it's crazy out there. Because like I said, there's a whole different world of hookers. And there's a whole different world of freaks, right? Mm-hmm. Like you see... Like, I'm on a website. I won't say the name of the website. You know what I mean? But then, like, you start seeing, like, oh, people, they're in Kenosha and they're in Waukegan. You know what I mean? It's like a site for freaks.
Really?
You know what I mean? Yeah.
You got to give it to me.
Yeah. I don't know. Fat life. But I don't know.
Oh, my God. No.
You know what I mean? So if you see a guy with his dick out in a Tesla, that might be me. I don't know. You know, but it's like, you know, it's, and then you see, it's like, oh, it's funny because it opens a window. It's like a whole different world,
a whole different world,
you never knew about. And, you know what I mean?
And I closed that door shut. I can't fuck with that.
Well, I'm glad that door. I used to have comics hit me up. Like, comics would hit me up because I would tell hooker stuff on stage, and comics would be, they would message me as like, "Hey, I've been thinking about doing," like, I've been that guy where people message me and they're like, "I'm thinking about fucking a hooker." And I was like, "All right, well, this is how you do it." Because first of all, no Asians, because they're all cops. They put that Asian girl on. There's like a pretty Asian, mm-hmm. like any Asian, unless she looks like a dirty
Asian. You know what I mean? Like,
my thing is,
I called the police station before.
How are you a grown man and never fucked a hooker before? That's like standard. Like, like, what the fuck you been doing your whole life? Like,
James, you ever fuck a hooker?
No.
Never?
No, I haven't.
What, you been in church your whole life?
Yes.
Church got some freaks.
Jesus is my hooker.
Here's the thing. He fucked a hooker. He just didn't know she was a hooker.
You
bro.
Really think I need to fuck hookers?
Hey, man. I get laid. I get
come
pussy.
On, bro.
I get pussy.
They come to me.
I just said.
But they're still hookers, bro.
No.
don't know they're hookers.
Look, this is the thing. So on New Year's Eve, I was kind of drinking, and my girlfriend's been making fun of me because I made this comment. Mm-hmm. I was talking to some dude, right? He must have said something annoying me because all of a sudden she comes back in the bathroom. She just hears me at the table saying something like, man, I get pussy, right? So she's right. Now she just makes fun of me for saying this comment. But like I said, back then I can get laid. You know what I mean? But I didn't have a problem getting pussy.
And here's the thing. It's not like when we say hooker, it's not like fucking Red Shoe Diaries woman walking up and down the street. She like, you can meet a chick.
I did that.
Okay.
I've done that. That too, was sketchy, but I did it. We've done it. But
I'm talking about,
avoid those.
I'm talking about you're riding around in the hood. This is how it happens to me, right? You're riding around the hood. You meet a girl. Y'all probably go to White Castle's.
Oh, I went there yesterday.
Right?
For sure.
You go get a hotel room. Mm-hmm. You fuck. Mm-hmm. And she'd be like, hey, give me $60. She's a fucking hooker. You know what I'm saying? But she's not fucking patrolling. Just like, she's going to need something for her services. You know, her kids might need some milk. It could be anything. It could be, hey, I need to wash my clothes. Just give me $20. You a hooker. You know what I'm saying? And if you ever gave a woman money after you had sex with her within like an hour, she's a fucking hooker. So you fucked a hooker, James. You just don't know it.
I guess every man has fucked a hooker.
That's all I'm saying, bro.
Okay.
Well, yeah,
by that criteria, then yeah, sure.
Yeah. If you're like, hey, the $40 is on the dresser, just take that. She's a fucking hooker.
If ever
bro.
Bought a woman dinner, yeah. You fuck it. What the fuck? Yes. Get the fuck out of there, dude.
You fuck hookers, bro.
Sorry, honey.
Yeah.
Yeah, go out, steak dinner. Like, I shouldn't. What I say, there's nothing free in this world.
Nothing.
Free drinks, there's not. You know what I mean?
Nothing.
There's nothing. It's. Whenever there's a favor or something like that, there's something behind it.
Like, and paying for it or giving somebody $40, like, that keeps you out of prison. Because you can't get me too'd if you gave a bitch $40 after that. It's like, I paid you.
We have a legal binding contract.
I gave you $50. What did you tell me about? Bill Cosby went to prison because he never paid anyone.
Oh, my fucking God.
If you was slipping...
I'd write a check.
You was slipping $100, like, before... Well, nobody said nothing.
Oh, my God.
Is he out? Is he out of jail?
He is out.
He's out of jail.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Bill,
get out of jail,
Bill Cosby.
On a technicality.
What was the technicality?
So there was the way that the prosecution handled the witnesses, I think, was...
They drugged them.
they went against like an agreed upon method. Like, it was basically witness tampering, I think the defense was trying to say. So yeah, he got off on a technicality.
You ever see Law Abiding Citizen?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just saw that the other day.
I watch that like at least once a week. I love that movie.
You seen it, right, James? Law Abiding Citizen with
Jamie Foxx.
And the other guy.
No. The dude who play in all those movies that he killed.
He's not the gladiator, but he's the other guy. Oh, he's from 300, right?
He's from 300, and he plays
300.
Like, All Fall Down, all the movies where he's protecting the president. Yeah.
Gerard Butler.
I love Gerard Butler.
Have I seen
this?
I might have seen
that. So, you never seen Law Abiding Citizen?
I never saw it until the other week. My girl gave me the same reaction. She's like, you never seen
Law Abiding
Citizen?
I might have seen this.
Go to the trailer.
Yeah, they killed his kids and wife.
This is a helicopter.
It's a dope movie.
Jamie Foxx is the...
Prosecutor. Yeah.
Okay. And Gerard is the bad guy?
No, he's the dad.
He's the dad.
Oh, for sure. Okay. He gets the shit happens to him. Okay.
And
he's a beast.
Oh, this is a great scene. He's butt naked. Like Steve Harvey used to get on the radio V100 back in the day.
Butt naked.
Butt naked. Our school bus driver used to play Steve Harvey. Hands up. I'm naked. I ain't got nothing to hide. So if you get arrested, just get naked. If you got SWAT coming to your house.
Would that stop them from killing you? How do they put jeans on him, though?
I think he just took his shirt off.
No, he was naked. He was naked. He was butt naked. Okay.
They're not going to shoot you with your dick out.
Okay, interesting. That was just a scene.
What kind of fucking trailer was that?
I think it was a scene.
That was
that fucking trailer. So this is basically what happens. Or you explain, like, he gets...
So Gerard Butler plays a guy, just a regular dude,
mm-hmm.
and his wife and kid, they was all in the house one night, and some guys came in and raped his wife.
No ring light. They just, he opened the door. He opened shit. The, he just opens open the door. And they, don't do that.
They rape her and kill her. But the story thickens when Jamie Foxx and the DEA, they like basically lets off the people who did it. Like give them a light sentence and make a deal.
Why?
Is that ever explained?
No.
Because they wanted to get the other guy or
no,
something.
No, because he wanted to keep his percentage of, like you know how what they do. So
he wanted to get
their quotas or something.
Yeah, he wanted to keep his DEA rating of you know not losing a case.
Yeah.
So if you make a deal and they get this guy, okay, he go to jail, but he didn't get life of
he got the other guy. Make sure he wanted to get the other guy.
So this dude, Gerard Butler, what they didn't know was he was some type of special agent or something,
mm-hmm.
and he knew, and he basically got back everybody who had something to do with that case, from the judge.
Oh, hell. So he, like, hunts everybody down?
Everybody.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm watching it's this tonight, cool.
That was
bro.
Dope. It's dope. It's
once
dope.
A week. Just watch it once a week.
Law-abiding citizen.
I love movies that people, like, do shit like that. Like get their own justice.
Shit.
Yeah, I love that shit.
Yeah.
That's how I want to do to Lori Lightfoot. Can I say that?
Absolutely. Allegedly. You want to write a movie about it.
Yeah, I want to write a movie about a city that put boots on your cars and you just seek revenge.
Yeah,
like,
yes.
I live in the suburbs.
You live in the burbs.
And I would never move to Chicago because of the boots, the tax. Oh, yeah. It's like, man, dude. It's like always sun. They're taxing the air. It's they fuck with you out here. You,
it's like $1,000 to get your boot off now.
Yeah, yeah.
It's crazy.
It's retarded. I can't say that neither.
You can say that. It's
you can say retarded. We have Brian Johnson on here. Put Brian Johnson for the
fucking
podcast.
Fucking God.
But I'd come up here, dude, and I'd get tickets doing open mics. I did. It was part of my budget, $150 a month, because I would get three fucking tickets. I was at the Den Theater, and this motherfucker gave me a ticket.
Oh, they're ruthless on Milwaukee Avenue, dude.
And the fucked up thing was, I fought the ticket and I won it, because it was before the app. I would put the quarters in the thing, and I had my thing, and it was parked. And then I saw I got a ticket, and I was like, how the fuck did I get a ticket? And I looked at it, I was like, I had my thing out displayed, I paid for it, and I found the dude. I was like, hey, man. Why'd you give me a ticket? This is paid for. And he was like, that was me. You're the only guy in the street.
They're ninjas, bro.
But he gave me a ticket, even though I had my thing. He was like, they taken me anyways, and I fought, and I won it. It's like, fuck, dude.
We were talking about M. Brown earlier. So, like, a block away from where you got that ticket was the original spot for stand-up. And M. Brown was headlining that night. He parked his car. He already had two tickets on. So one more, he gets the boot. Like, he's not inside even, like, 4 minutes booted immediately. Two cop cars pulled up behind him, blocked the street so they could put the boot on. So then we just had to use the show to, like, get him money to pay for the boot.
Damn.
They're so quick on Milwaukee Avenue, dude.
It's this thing in comedy in Chicago that they say, you're not a real stand-up comic until you get a boot. That's the test.
Because you're out there hustling, getting booted.
If you ain't got a boot on your car or came out from doing a show and your car is gone or repoed, you ain't doing comedy right. That's crazy, man.
I got my shit. So I used to live in this place called The Towers, where it's this 14-story Section 8 building in Waukegan. And they
Section 8?
Mm-hmm.
No way. In Waukegan?
Waukegan,
they got
yeah.
Section 8 out
Hell
there.
Hell yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, Section 8. Dude, Waukegan has some shitty ass parts to it. Section 8, yeah. The towers are shitty, right?
So really? It was like sounds
a,
nice.
It was like a, it was not nice. It was like a mini Cabrini Green little tower in the middle of downtown Waukegan. Security, I told you, the first day I moved in, somebody got pushed out the 14th floor.
Really?
Because we moved in because it was basically cheap for us to move because my mom, that my dad, I think, just got deported.
Lakeside Towers?
Yeah, Lakeside Towers.
That's it right there?
Uh-huh.
It looks nice.
it's not nice. One star. Zero reviews. Verified laughing.
Is it still up right now?
Hell yeah.
And that's is those the rents right there? 1500?
People live there for free. I lived there. We started at $230 a month because it was subsidized.
That's okay. Crazy.
And it started moving up. And there are people there for, living for free because it's subsidized, right? So then my shit got towed because I got a fucking...
They remodeled it. It looked nice now.
No. No. It's not nice. You know what I hate about it? The elevator. You never knew when the elevator was going to break or not break on it. It was this big metal elevator. It's slowly, mm-hmm. and it's...
So let me
every seventh time you get stuck in it. You know what I mean?
Let me ask you this.
Or breaking. You got to go up the stairs.
Have you ever been in a project in Chicago? Like Cabrini Green, Robert Taylor's? Have you ever been inside of one of those, ever?
In the projects, no.
Never.
Not that I think of. I'm
so when
I've been to Englewood and stuff. I used to
that
deliver.
That shit don't count. Because the projects was a different level, okay? You got Englewood is still ghetto and bogus and all that, right? But the projects was lower than that. You know what I'm saying? It was, like, worse than that. So when I look at that building, that shit is nice, bro.
Hey, you know what? It's like Cook County and Lake County Jail, because my dad's been in both. And I remember when I went to visit him at Cook County Jail, I was like, man, this is not cool. Bro, like, you got to get the fuck out of here, dude.
Cabrini Green.
Which doesn't exist anymore.
Or Robert Taylor.
That's where they film Candyman, right?
Yeah.
You walk in, no lights work. They sell weed on the 7th floor. They sell crack on the 10th floor. You have to walk up the steps. The security guard is chained or handcuffed to his post, and he's telling you to call for help. And you're like,
Jesus.
You're like, you are the help. Like, and you just walk to your apartment, bro, and you don't speak to nobody. You don't say nothing. It was rough. Like, and people lived there every day, and it was rough, bro. That shit. I my sister stayed in the projects.
Which, Robert Taylor?
Robert Taylor's, bro.
Are they still up or not?
Hell no. Hell no. All the high-rise projects, they got tore down.
Cabrini Green is a Target now.
Yeah.
It is?
Yeah. It's a Target next to a police station.
Yeah. What is that? Okay, that's the area?
Yeah, that's a Target right there. And that's where the towers were.
That's crazy, bro. Yeah. See that that building right there?
This one?
No. Up.
This guy?
Nope. To the left, that motherfucker right there, bro.
Oh, where's that?
What is that? Is that the Robert Taylor's or the Icky's?
Which one's the Icky's?
Icky's was on 22nd Street. The Harold, that's Cabrini Green.
Yeah, that's Cabrini.
Yeah, that shit was rough, bro. That was rough. And that's why our generation was so tough. Look at that playground. Go back up to that playground.
Yeah, what the fuck,
that produced rough kids, bro. That's why our basketball players was dumb. Look.
Looks like a prison yard.
That's a playground for children, bro.
God, dude.
Fucking candy cane post and the swings. And it's
damn, look at those swings.
It's no woodchucks. These kids got woodchucks and plastic sliding boards.
Play school.
We had all metal. Our swings was fucking metal and rusted chains.
That's wild.
Yeah, that's crazy, bro. Yeah, when they tore that shit down, we was happy, man. We was like, yeah. And usually in the projects, they put the largest families on the first floor because the first floor had the biggest apartments. Mm-hmm. So the Phipps and the Johnsons and the Williams and all of the families with the most kids, it was all on the first floors. It was crazy, bro.
That's wild.
Yeah.
So you had a you gave yourself a wild tattoo when you were in high school or what?
I did. How you know?
I told you, dude.
How the fuck you know that?
He knows,
Mom.
Bro, I don't even know how you know. Like, how can you know that? Because I don't even think I put that in like a place where, dude.
Because now it's the lady from the ring, right, or something?
Nope.
You covered that up too?
I'm getting it covered up. I'm in the process.
Because you had a panther, you had the wow,
dude. How
the
you
panther?
How the
fuck you know this shit?
And then the white supremacist, was it a Mexican Nazi?
So what happened was when I started getting tattoos at 11, I was 11 years old.
Ink and Needle.
Yeah, I'm Ink and Needle, this dude named fucking Nate Brown. See, I'm getting that covered up.
Oh, look, he already started the cover-up process.
Yeah. So this guy, he showed us do the Ink and Needle joint. So he did one on my leg that's still on my leg, say MP. So I went to the crib with the Ink and Needle, and I put mom like this, M-O-M. But when people saw it, it said, wow. So when I went to school, bro, they lit my ass up. They was like, what the hell? This dude got wow on his arm. So I lived on 43rd and Kilpatrick at the time. And it was SDs over there. This SD guy, he was a Saint Disciple. Mm-hmm. His name was Baby. He used to do tattoos. So he scared me into, hey, bro, let me fix that for you. I'm like, no, I'm good. Hey, motherfucker, I said, let me. I was like, sure. So he put this panther over it, right? He put all these colors, and I'm like, bro, colors don't stay in black people. He's like, no, you're going to be fine. You're going to be cool. About 2 days later, it looked nothing like it just went away. And I had that for about 5 or 6 years. Then I let a person put like a demon on it. So now I'm going with a lion. He's putting a lion on it.
And it's good.
It hurt it so bad, I forgot how bad it hurts. I stopped. And I'm like, bro, I need another session. I'm not doing this shit. And I haven't been back. I might just leave it like this. It hurts, bro.
I heard you should drink while you get tattooed. It feels better.
Really? But see, I don't drink and I don't smoke. Mm. So I don't got nothing. I'm like, you don't have no... I'm like, ain't there some cream out that you can numb your arm?
But nowadays, I would figure there was something.
Yeah, lidocaine.
Like, he's like, I don't got it. Whatever it is. He's like, and this guy is so talented, though. His name is Solo Raw. He's dope. He's dope. Yeah, he's going to finish it, though. But it hurt it so bad, bro. How do you know about that tattoo?
My first look, I made the same mistake. Uh-huh. Not the same mistake. I went to a tattoo shop when I was 18.
Okay.
The reason the thing's called the Lobo Den, I used to have a Rottweiler named Lobo. And then my dad was nickname was Lobo. Lobo Tejano, he got deported. So they sent the dog away allegedly because he bit up, it was a Rottweiler. He started biting people.
Okay.
So they sent him away. And then my mom hated tattoos. So I was pissed. So I drove over the border of Wisconsin because you could be 18 and get a tattoo. So I went. I got this little tattoo. It says Lobo on my back. And it was tiny.
Okay.
So then, because I agree with the guy. I went and I was like, hey, I want to get, you know, the dude from Sublime. He had the big Sublime tattoo on his back. I was like, yeah, it's going to be like that across my back.
You want it, but you want it Lobo.
Yeah, I was going to be Lobo, right?
What does that mean?
Lobo? Wolf, wolf. Lobo means wolf in
Spanish.
Why
you just can't get wolf, nigga?
Because Mexican. We didn't get called wolf, right?
Lobo.
My dad, because it was like, this is how I saw it. If I get this tattoo, it'll be the dog, it's my dad's, and it was kind of a nickname I had, so it's like trifecta. It's, that way I'm just not getting some dogs in my back.
Wow.
But then, when I went back the next day, the guy was like, oh no, we said it was this big. It's this tiny little Lobo thing. And I was like, that's not what I said. That's not what I agreed to.
Right.
I'm arguing. I'm like, man, if I don't get this now, maybe I'll never get a tattoo. And I was like, just fucking do it. You know what I mean? So I just got this little Lobo. I'll show you. I had this little Lobo.
It's still on there?
Yeah. But I got it filled out. Can you see it? The little Lobo?
Yeah. Yes. That's a prison tat, bro.
Yeah.
He definitely can fix it.
Yeah, so down the line, I got the two dogs from American History X that James Orton had on. They're supposed to be Rottweilers. And then that to fill it out.
Okay.
But then this one, I got, where is it? JD. I went to a tattoo shop. And I didn't know what to get. So I was like, I don't know, my initials is stupid. Like, I have an idea or something like that. And then, so then I'm down for a little. I want to get some tattoos, but I took a little break for.
Yeah,
I just don't want to pay for them.
Yeah, they're expensive now, man. And everybody's booked up. It's crazy. He's like 7 months booked out. So that's why it's hard for him to get me back in. But yeah, that's crazy, bro. I don't want any more, man. I'm done.
Piercings?
Nah. Nah. Just my
ear. I wanted to get my nipples pierced when I was younger because
really?
Because of fucking Silence of the Lambs. I saw that scene with Buffalo Bill and I was like, dudes can pierce their nipples? Nah. And then I never did it because in case you get in a fight, they can rip it off.
You a freak, bro.
Yes, that is correct. It's my fucking dad's fault, dude. It's my fucking dad's fault.
So you know how many Lobo, like, I never knew that meant wolf. I know so many guys that call themselves Lobo.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So that's Wolf. I'm going to text him like, what's going on, Wolf?
Because my dad was a coyote, but now he's a Lobo. Ooh. All right, so we're going to close. Do you have anything you want to plug? Any last words? Any last?
Man, it's been an hour already.
Yeah, 50 minutes.
Just, man, follow me on social media, man. Marvin Phipps, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok. Trying to grow my stuff.
How was it? I wanted to ask you, how was it? You performed at Chicago Theater, right? Mm-hmm. You opened for Tracey Morgan. How was that?
It was the best and the worst time ever. Okay. It was the best because I learned so much, but it was the worst because Tracey Morgan was like so mean.
Oh.
Yeah, this was pre
Walmart accident. Billionaire. Yeah.
So he was real like bitter and mean. But the shit that he was telling me was the truth. You know what I'm saying? But I'm like, I'm new in the game. And he's like, you're not Eddie Murphy. You know, you're not fucking Eddie Murphy. You've been doing comedy, but now that I've been doing it as long as I've been doing it, I really understand like what he was saying to me, you know? And it was good advice, you know? I was dressed up and, you know, he was like, nigga, that shit ain't, be funny. You know what I'm saying? Just be funny. But he was mean. He was a fucking asshole. And they didn't let me do my set. The whole time I was performing, it was another guy like right there on stage with me.
Really?
Yeah, it was like,
who was that? One of his guys? Or
I'm like, what y'all? You know what I'm saying? So it was like, but the cool thing is I got paid $1,000. I got to like get my family and friends in, but they didn't let me get off like how I wanted to. But Tracey Morgan crowd or audience is different. It's like, it was like all white people. And the first thing he said when he came out was like, all right, who's going to suck my dick? And they go fucking crazy. Like,
you can't do it in the black room.
I'm like, this dude. But yeah, Tracey, it was cool though. You know, I ain't seen him since. Shit, now he's buying Bugattis and crazy stuff.
All right, so some advice. If you're out there on the highway, run into a Walmart truck. Maybe you see one near you. Or maybe Amazon. Get some money from Chess Bezos. So Marvin Phipps on Instagram.
Mm-hmm. Everything.
You got a TikTok?
Everything is Marvin Phipps. I made it simple for people, man. Marvin Phipps, MarvinPhipps. I got shows coming up. I don't know where, but I got them coming up. I got some stuff coming. Zanies that James going to put together for me. Today. I can't think of shit, but
it'll be out. Just message me.
I got stuff.
It'll be out in a few weeks. James, anything to plug?
Stand up is back, motherfucker.
When you gonna put me on there, bro?
March, what are you doing March 17th?
March 17th.
It's a Thursday, 9 p.m. What are you doing?
I'll be doing stand-up.
That's right. That's fucking right. Stand-up is back March 3rd at Zanies Comedy Club at 9 p.m. every single Thursday for the rest of time. Starting off with Erica Nicole Clark is headlining the first one. We haven't booked the second one, but we're working on that. And Marvin Phipps will be headlining the third one. Why the fuck not on the 17th of March? So please go to standupstandup.net for tickets. Again, that's Thursday nights at Zanies Comedy Club in Old Town. It's Blake Burkhart, it's Mo Good, it's Mike Robinson, it's Mike Myers, it's Eric Emerson, and Julia Stoyanova is helping me with production. It's going to be a fucking blast. Also, please follow Zanies Digital, at Zanies Digital on Instagram and TikTok for all the best comics in Chicago and the world, on Zanies stages. And lastly, please go to youtube.com/Zanies and, throw us a subscribe, throw us a like, watch all the content coming out from there.
Follow Lobo Den Podcast on Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, Lobo Den Podcast, Lobo Den Podcast, YouTube. Add me on YouTube. Tell a friend about the podcast. Go to the Patreon. Lower tier, $3 a month. Help support the podcast. I'm having a baby, and I need to, and I don't do drugs anymore that much. So, you know, that's cheap. And also, if Puerto Ricans. No, you know what? I enjoy watching bukkake pornography, but I would never want to be part of one. I don't want so much dick and cum around me. That's disgusting. Okay, Lobo Den.